Tanta Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Fool, In Search of Henry VIII's Closest Man, by Peter K. Andersson. Narrated by Mike Cooper. Publisher's note. In this audio edition, you will hear references to figures present in the print and ebook formats of the book. The stories we choose not to tell about the Tudors are as revealing as those we do. Charlotte Higgins, Tudor Mania. Why can't we get over it? I am but a fool. Neil Sedaka, O'Carroll. Chapter 1. Introduction. The history of the English court in the age of the Tudors is rife with intrigue, sectarianism, war, and paranoia. From the tumultuous era of Henry VIII to the successful reign of Elizabeth I, via the boy king Edward VI and Mary Tudor's brief Catholic rule, the political turmoil of the 16th century remains a continuous obsession and point of reference in British history. But amid religious and political power struggles, there was one man, completely detached from all this, with whom King Henry spent perhaps more time than any other. A man whose presence at the absolute centre of the corridors of power during the Tudor era today seems like a flagrant anomaly. A man who had constant access to the king's most private quarters and who must have been alone with him daily, but whose importance has been overlooked in favour of politicians, bishops, philosophers, councillors, courtiers, lords, ladies and other royalty. His name was William Sommer, and he was Henry VIII's fool. The name first appears in court records in 1535, when the king was in his mid-40s, and continues to crop up in documents during the rest of Henry's reign and in those of Edward VI and Mary Tudor. William Sommer is even listed as an attendant at the coronation of Queen Elizabeth in 1559. He appears next to Henry in no less than 4 portraits of him, and the royal accounts list several expensive gifts of clothing to him from 1535 until as late as November 1558. After his death in June 1559, he began to gain a posthumous reputation as one of the greatest comic figures of the age, often with a tinge of nostalgia for the days before Queen Bess. Thomas Nash made him a lead character in his only preserved play, Sommer's Last Will and Testament, 1592, and he figures prominently in history plays such as Samuel Rowley's When You See Me, You Know Me, 1605. When Shakespeare's clown Robert Armin compiled his great chronicle of famous English fools, Fool Upon Fool, 1600, the inclusion of Will Sommer was a given, and as late as 1637, a book purporting to tell his life story, usually dismissed as unreliable, was published. The man who stares back at us from the group portraits with Henry and his children, looming behind the royal figures, is perhaps one of the most mysterious individuals of Tudor history. By all accounts, an entertainer and comic, he appears in every depiction gaunt and morose, a curious combination of sage and crofter. According to Robert Armin, Sommer had the ability to raise the king's spirits and spent many hours in his private quarters improvising doggerel verse. Could this be the same person whose enigmatic presence in the background of the royal portraits casts such an eerie shadow over the entire painting? When modern historians attempt to describe him, they're never able to resolve the question of whether Sommer was a simpleton, retained as an amusing idiot, or a shrewd comedian who could speak freely in front of the king, and often did. The posthumous image of him has been entangled with the real individual, and no one has really fully tried to disentangle them. But achieving that would provide us with a unique window into both the life of the court and fundamental conceptions of humour, humanity, and deviance in the Renaissance. Judging from the frequency of references to him in 16th and 17th century literature, Will Sommer was one of the most famous men of his age, and yet, to this day, no one has attempted to write his biography. Only in recent years have biographies of Henry VIII seen fit to mention Sommer at all, reflecting a transition in interest away from the purely political to accounts that also consider things like court culture, mentalities, and the royal household. In the more traditional books on Henry VIII and his times, by the likes of John Guy, David Starkey, and J.J. Scarisbrick, a man like Sommer never gets a mention. The works that have shaped the public image of the Tudor age in the early 21st century, the TV drama series The Tudors, 2007 to 2010, and Hilary Mantel's trilogy of novels about Thomas Cromwell, 2009 to 2020, paint a broad enough picture to include summer briefly, but the attention is still focused on the monumental men of the age. We're better served by popular biographers such as Tracy Borman and Alison Weir, who paid due attention to a man who seems to have been an important presence in the king's life, even though the lack of sources and Summer's distance from the rest of court life mean he is present on only a few scattered pages. Weir presents us with a colourful description of the fool's performance. He had monarch and courtiers in fits of laughter as he thrust his comical face through a gap in the arras. Then, with a monkey on his shoulder, he would mince around the room, rolling his eyes. The monkey might perform tricks, and Somers would tell jokes, himself laughing uncontrollably at the punchlines, or mercilessly impersonating those who were the butts of his jests. The scene is truly striking, but Weir cites no sources for this passage, and closer scrutiny of the available evidence reveals that her account is a fictionalized vignette. It is, in fact, doubtful whether Summer's personality and fooling were of this manner at all, and Weir's characterization of Summer as a comedian, although thought-provoking, is not entirely accurate. A man like Summer is not as important as a Cardinal Wolsey or a Thomas Cromwell if the political life of the era is in focus, which it usually is when historians take an interest in the reign of Henry VIII, and when they don't, it is often Henry's six wives and his role as a husband that attract people's attention. The story of Will Summer sheds light on other things, like how people with a disability or an eccentric turn of mind have been treated in history, the relation between royalty and commoners in the Renaissance, and notions of what constituted comedy in the early modern period. Historians have written interesting books on the history of fools and jesters, revealing their diversity, the philosophy behind employing them, and how folly was perceived and comprehended, but the scattered pieces of evidence on which historians are often forced to rely have meant that the history of the fool is many times contradictory and inconclusive, haunted by combinations of material from different origins and a reproduction of myths or unfounded claims that have been taken as truths. Furthermore, the perspectives and experiences of the fools themselves are almost never considered, and there has been no modern biography of an individual fool. Why is this? The main reason is simple enough, although also intriguing. Very few court jesters left behind any substantial source material. The comic entertainers who authored pamphlets, jest books, or plays were generally clowns of the stage or educated writers. Fools appear to have been antithetical to writing, and those who did write, like Francisco de Zúñiga, jester to Charles V of Spain, or Juan Polo, the Italian commedia dell'arte clown, had a discrepant identity. The ideal fool was a man who detested and mocked learning. Many of the clowns in Elizabethan and Jacobean drama, at some point in the play, either explicitly comment on their distance to learning, or in other ways employ comical misinterpretations or mispronunciations of fancy words. The fictional version of Will Summer, in Thomas Nashe's Summer's Last Will and Testament, even exclaims, "I profess myself an open enemy to ink and paper." I'm not really interested in the interior life of Summer, but rather his personality, his behaviour, and how he was viewed and used by the people around him. That, I think, was where he expressed himself, and it was what people noted and remembered of him. The fool lived and worked in the oral and corporeal realm rather than the literate. The jest was an art form that existed when it was performed and then disappeared, unless it entered into court gossip, then folklore, and subsequently perhaps inspired a writer. The most foundational aspect of the early modern concept of folly is usually said to be the distinction made between artificial and natural fools. But when studied up close, it seems that all court jesters were natural fools in some way or another, hired because of a physical or intellectual disability, or thanks to their plebeian or rustic character, deemed amusing in its contrasting relation to the conduct of the court. Even the artificial fools, who were sometimes viewed as the equivalent of modern comedians, often came from humble origins and based their humour on simulating stupidity. To have a fool who was a skilled poet or writer then would have been a contradiction. Thus, when reading works on fools by John Southworth or Beatrice Otto, you'll find that the closest we get to the fools is in household accounts detailing what clothes they wore and in portrait paintings documenting their physical appearance. There is, then, very scant source material on most court fools, and this is also true of William Sumner. He shares with other fools the fate of becoming the subject of mythology and jest books after his death, and the tales and portrayals of this posthumous reputation are often used to characterise and describe the fools, even in modern times. A paucity of reliable sources has not deterred historians from writing biographies of men like Charlemagne or even Jesus. The material available to those who undertake such a task mainly consists of chronicles written centuries after the subject's death, or accounts written with a hidden agenda. As medieval historian Janet Nelson has pointed out, the unknowability of another human being is there for the biographer of a 20th century public figure just as much as for the biographer of an early medieval king or a Renaissance fool. Historical figures of which merely the myth remains are given biographies frequently, primarily because they are kings and queens, politicians and military leaders. I sometimes wonder if there would have been biographies of the clown Richard Tarleton, the fool Archie Armstrong and the actor Richard Burbage, all important men in the history of British entertainment, if they had been kings or serious poets. Renowned microhistorian Natalie Zimon Davis asserts in her book on the 16th century African diplomat Leo Africanus that she is presenting to the reader a history of silences, in which she allowed herself greater freedom than most historians for filling the gaps where the sources were silent. In her book, she includes a lot of conjecture and speculation about what her protagonist might have thought or what his motivations could have been. This is a venture which requires, as her reviewer Maxine Berg notes, extensive contextual research, which permits her to reconstruct the man out of the persons, places, and texts that he could plausibly have encountered. What she writes is a speculative history, a plausible life story. This approach in Davis's work can be traced back to her breakthrough book, The Return of Martin Guerre, 1983, where she attests in a foreword how, in the absence of sufficient source material, she endeavoured to uncover not proofs, but historical possibilities. This concept has subsequently been elaborated by Finnish historian Hannu Salmi, emphasising the historian's need to consider what possibilities were open to people of the past at a given moment. This applies especially to those people about whom we can learn only very little from the source material. Just as astrophysicists can determine features about black holes on the basis of inferences based on evidence about that which surrounds them, so also can historians draw inferences about the past even when it no longer offers any direct evidence about its nature. And as a final addition to this conglomerate of methodological approaches, we might append Swedish historian Eva Österberg's words about the possibility of writing biographies of the silent. Her contention stipulates that although it is not possible to write a full biography of all the twists and turns in a person's life when our knowledge of it is fragmented, we might write an existential microhistory, which focuses on a certain chosen path of the individual's life which has proved fateful for their subsequent way of living, or a condition that has afflicted the individual without their own influence but has nonetheless shaped their life in some way. In order to understand this, the historian constructs a wider context of mentalities, culture, or politics. So, how close can we get to a court fool who hasn't left behind any written records? Can we write his biography? Fool, in search of Henry VIII's closest man, is not a conventional biography, hence its somewhat elusive subtitle. When faced with a type of source material that has been produced after a person's death, the historian often adopts a strategy of studying representations of the person rather than the person themselves, and for such an investigation there would be more than adequate material in this case, but I will here attempt a sort of middle way. Starting in the posthumous legend of the great comic Will Summers, S-U-M-M-E-R-S, as his name was spelled after his death, I will peel away the layers of myth in order to gradually move closer to the man himself. His life's trajectory and mine can be only partly pieced together, so a common biography is out of the question. But what we can attempt is a study of his role and function in the social world of the royal court, which brings us closer to both the individual and perceptions of him. What type of fool was he? And what does this say about fools and early modern views of disability or deviance? What place and role did he have in the court? How did his surroundings treat and view him? How are his actions and utterances spread and quoted? And what attitude towards him does this reveal? One might object that any fool would do in order to answer these questions. Why not choose one who is better documented? Because in Summer, we find a combination of the celebrity that Renaissance fools enjoyed as opposed to their medieval counterparts, the proximity of popular humour to the nucleus of power, and an intriguing example of the ambivalent personality of the court fool that transcended the border between natural and artificial. To following generations, Will Summer constituted the fool, and his occupation differed from that of Elizabethan clowns such as Richard Tarleton and Will Kemp, who, though hailed as great comics and favoured by royalty, were stage actors and performers of a wholly different slant. And ironically, although a list of contemporary references to him will fit on the back of a postcard, Summer is an unusually well-documented fool. But the primary reason for focusing on an individual fool is to finally release the many men and women who were labelled fools during the early modern period from the oppression of the terminology. In fact, to the early moderns, terms such as fool were not as categorical and clear-cut as they have become in modern historiography, and this can be applied to many epistemological terms. I would like to give just one of all these fools the opportunity to be considered as an individual, and thus to discover whether, after that, he remains just a fool, or is something more complex, and perhaps also in turn makes the word fool more complex. We live in an age where social categories are perhaps more labelling and constricting than they have ever been. Repeatedly, we see how people with an intellectual disability, for instance, are in public only allowed to be representatives of their diagnosis. I therefore consider it relevant to look at an individual beyond categories such as natural and artificial fool without ruminating on which category is the more suitable. The impossibility of the answer, the unreachability of the man himself, is exactly the point. Our knowledge of the historical figure of the fool owes much to Enid Welsford's pivotal 1935 book on the subject, which in its comprehensiveness and observations has yet to be surpassed. At the same time, it fails to place the fools in their proper historical context, and its conclusions are often based on anecdotal or uncorroborated evidence which has contributed to distorting the image of the fool. This partly mythical image has lived on in later works, which, although many times insightful, have mingled the fool as a literary archetype with the fools of real life. The first real attempt at writing a history of fools by consulting archival records was made by John Southworth in 1998, resulting in the unearthing of many hitherto unknown facts. His project was marred, however, by misinterpretations and, as has been observed by reviewers, a tendency to reproduce the myths he set out to eschew. Recent works in disability history have shed light on the blurred line between natural and artificial fools in the early modern period. Alice Equestri has shown how all types of fools, whether intellectually disabled or counterfeit, were viewed according to some notion of disability. A large portion of this school of research relies on Shakespeare's portrayal of fools, and Wes Falkirth has argued, based on the immense diversity of fool types in Shakespeare, that 16th century conceptions of fools, and indirectly intelligence, were flexible and inclusive. Falkirth even speculates how communities responded to local fools according to their individual differences, rather than any consistent definition of disability. The hazy identity of William Summer is his chief characteristic. Southworth is one of only two writers who have attempted to compose a biographical account of him. The other is his biographer in the Oxford Dictionary of National Biography, J.R. Mulrine, who compiled a very brief but informative entry. The main theme of both articles is the question of whether Summer was a natural or artificial fool. It is Southworth who is most adamant in claiming that he was an innocent, referring to the posthumous nature of the witty sayings attributed to him, the fact that he does not appear to have received any wages, and a record of Edward VI appointing a keeper for him. This last point is the most decisive for Southworth's conclusion, but it has also been noted that a fool's keeper could simply refer to a servant of some sort. Closer inspection indicates that the case is not quite as clear-cut as Southworth has it, even though Summer's status as a great wit and comedian is certainly a later fiction. Mulrine has little choice but to agree with Southworth, who is the only writer to pay Summer any extensive attention. It is curious, however, that a man who was of low intelligence or had learning difficulties should be seen by posterity as a genius comic and one of the greatest wits in history. How did this change come about, if that is the case? Or does the truth lie somewhere in between? Falkirth, Equestrie and other scholars' suggestion that the relationship between natural and artificial folly was more complex invites further study. Perhaps Thomas Nash knew more than he let on when he had his fictional version of Summer maintain that he was a fool by nature and by art. The chapters of this book take the form of concentric circles, slowly closing in on the elusive centre of attention as we proceed. The question is, will he even be there when we arrive? The second chapter, Legend, unravels the posthumous mythology around Summer, allowing us to work our way backwards to arrive at the first mythologizations of him in the years after his death. The third chapter, Idea, briefly reviews the theoretical perspectives on court life and Renaissance folly that might or might not become useful to us. In the following chapters, we start our journey towards the man himself, first by briefly considering, in the fourth chapter, what might be concluded about his origins. The fifth chapter, Place, traces the occurrence of Summer's name in the administrative records of the Tudor court in order to paint a picture both of the court where he worked and of his place in it. The sixth chapter, Features, examines the contemporary depictions of Summer's appearance in portraits and the possible symbolism of his external characteristics. The next two chapters are concerned with his personality. The seventh chapter is a study of his external traits, as described by those who knew him, and how those traits might have contributed to his role as a fool. The eighth chapter, Words, surveys contemporary allusions to Summer's sayings and humour in order both to come as close as possible to his comedic talent and mind and to perceive how the spread of his sayings reveals other courtiers' attitudes toward him. The ninth chapter, Role, summarises the observations of the previous two chapters by composing a picture of his role at court and how it related to the roles of others. The final chapter, Legacy, considers Summer's importance in terms of both his role while alive and his posthumous identity for the following development of comedy and fools. Can it even be that it is with him that a process towards modern comedy is begun? Chapter 2. Legend. By the 17th century, it had become common for comic writers to begin their works by summoning the spirits of past heroes of comedy. "Give room, ye ghosts of Tarleton, Scoggin, Somers," writes an anonymous pamphleteer in 1656, echoing John Taylor's words in a 1613 elegy, "Oh, were my wit inspired with Scoggin's vein, or that Will Somers' ghost had seized my brain, or Tarleton, Lanham, Singer, Kemp and Pope, or Tilting Archie." By this time, the list of comic legends had grown long. At the forefront were the first clowns of Elizabethan theatre, still within living memory, Richard Tarleton and his successor Will Kemp, but also the roster of comic actors of the late 16th century, John Laneham, John Singer and Thomas Pope. And to the 16th century readership, the name of Archie Armstrong, the then current court jester, was well known. Behind these recent greats were names that had gone from history into opaque folklore but were still mandatory inclusions on this list. Scoggin was said to have been jester to Edward IV and was already a semi or wholly mythical figure, and then there was the man who by this time virtually everyone referred to as Will Somers. Perhaps the most famous appearance of Will Somers in any work of literature is a non-appearance. It occurs in one of Shakespeare's last plays, Henry VIII, which he co-wrote with John Fletcher and was originally staged in 1613. The drama opens with a prologue in which the audience is forewarned of the fool's absence from the plot. Those who have come expecting to see a merry bawdy play and a fellow in a long motley coat guarded with yellow will be deceived. The removal of such an expected and beloved character as Henry VIII's fool from a play about Henry VIII evidently had to be commented on and in some way explained. Scholars have seen it as a result of the increasing marginalisation of clown characters from Jacobean drama after 1600, but also, in this particular case, as a consequence of the popular clown Robert Armin's retirement from the stage. Armin had made it his specialty to impersonate famous fools on stage, and he had both played and written about Will Sommer before. Shakespeare and Fletcher's discreet explaining away of Sommer is also illustrative of the status of this fool at the turn of the century. The real Sommer had been dead for 50 years, yet it is as if he were never more alive than in this period. When Sommer's name is mentioned, both in the early modern period and in modern research and literature, it is primarily the posthumous legend surrounding him that is evoked. Writers of fiction, from Elizabethan playwrights to 20th century novelists, have taken the anecdotes and myths disseminated in the decades after his death at face value. On the odd occasions when Sommer appears in modern fiction, he is often the archetypal clever, down-to-earth observer of the crazy events of his age. This depiction is not a crime, of course, but unfortunately it has occasionally led to the transmission of this mythological image to works of history. It is nigh on impossible to uncover how the myths around Sommer from the late 16th and early 17th centuries came about, but if we want to move closer to the real man, then it would be relevant to begin with the myths to discern between typical mythological tropes and peculiar details that might hail from his own lifetime. Is it possible to study myths about a historical figure in order to learn something about the times in which he lived and how he was viewed by the people who knew him? In folklore studies, the study of myths, particularly about outlaw heroes, has revealed the complex dynamics in creating folk heroes out of historical figures through an oral tradition that practically obliterates whatever remains of the actual attributes of the protagonist. They're simply inserted into a pre-existing mythological template that modifies them according to the characteristics of the hero in the established tale, making the hero more similar to a Robin Hood than they were in reality. The common view of folklorists is that historical figures that become main characters in oral folklore are simply appropriated and adapted to the deep-rooted structure of a popular tradition, and it is often possible to identify basic ancient folktale scenarios in the anecdotes related in early modern jest books and broadsides. But there are also sometimes little tropes and details in the documented stories that do not fit into the known pattern of oral tradition or folklore, and which, in some cases, might be the only possible sources of information about figures who have not left their mark in any other records. In his analysis of the jest biography of Richard Tarleton, Peter Thompson manages to identify several ingredients in the anecdotes that suggest a basis in reality, or at least an adaptation of the tradition to the protagonist of the tales. Things like stylistic features, the inclusion of seemingly gratuitous information, and uncomfortable qualities like the apparent ill temper of Tarleton contribute in creating a sense of proximity to the man himself. Principles regarding the portrayal of historical figures in literature differed during the Renaissance, but the modern adherence to fact and truthfulness was generally less important. The view of history as a cyclical process that expressed the same general truths and human qualities over and over again recognized historical actors as representations of general unchanging human types. Such a view might be used to reflect, for instance, on the way humorous anecdotes that circulated in jest books could be attributed to different comical personages, since the fool epitomised the same basic archetype regardless of whether they were named Long Meg of Westminster or John Skelton. This was often common practice when it came to ballads and broadsheets, and it was also the case in the use of woodcuts, where the same image of a man might be used to represent wholly different persons. But how does this rhyme with the notion that the Renaissance constituted what Jacob Burckhardt called the development of the individual, or what Harold Bloom referred to as the invention of the human? Although the idea that the Renaissance contained a flowering of a new type of individualism, common in older historical writing, has long since been a debated issue, the period also saw the publication of biographical and historical works modelled after classical patterns, such as Giorgio Vasari's Lives of the Artists and Raphael Holinshed's Chronicles. In his history of the biography, Nigel Hamilton singles out Sir Walter Raleigh as a writer who exemplifies the emerging attention to individual minds through his incitement to study the appearances and sayings of past individuals in order to grasp their internal natures. More recognisably biographical works only began to emerge in the late 17th and 18th centuries, however, first through the experimentations of men like John Aubrey and Thomas Fuller, and then more tangibly in Samuel Johnson and his contemporaries. This posits the late 16th and early 17th centuries in a liminal phase, where it is particularly difficult to judge the credibility and accuracy of information in literary works on historical figures. This period has been identified as an age of emergent, embodied writing, signifying a growing number of references to actual persons in both literature and theatre, and a new emphasis on the personal in works of the late Elizabethan era that articulated a nascent public sphere. Authors increasingly portrayed themselves in semi-fictional ways, and their friends or enemies were represented in similarly disguised versions. The vogue for both Will Sommer as a dramatic character and plays about the Tudors began in the 1590s.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.